Later, Jesus showed himself to his followers again, this time at Lake Galilee. This is how he showed himself. Some of the followers were together: Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the two sons of Zebedee, and two other followers. Simon Peter said, "I'm going out to fish." The others said, "We will go with you." So they went out and got into a boat. They fished that night but caught nothing. Early the next morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the followers did not know it was Jesus. Then he said to them, "Friends, did you catch any fish?" They answered, "No." He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." So they did, and they caught so many fish they could not pull the net back into the boat. The follower whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Peter heard him say this, he wrapped his coat around himself. Peter had taken his clothes off. Then he jumped into the water. The other followers went to shore in the boat, dragging the net full of fish. They were not very far from shore, only about 100 yards. When the followers stepped out of the boat and onto the shore, they saw a fire of hot coals. There were fish on the fire, and there was bread. Then Jesus said, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." Simon Peter went into the boat and pulled the net to the shore. It was full of big fish, 153 in all. But even though there were so many, the net did not tear. John 21:1-11. Father, we come to you again on bending knees before your throne. Thank you for the blessings that you have already bestowed upon us. And thank you for the blessings that you are giving us right now. And thank you for the blessings that you will give us tomorrow, Father, in the name of Jesus. Satan, we rebuke you in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, you must flee. Go in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for being our God. And thank you for the listeners. Bless them now, Father, in Jesus' name. The follower whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Peter heard him say this, he wrapped his coat around himself. Peter had taken his clothes off. Then he jumped into the water. May the reading of God's word bless your heart. The sun was in the water before Peter noticed it. The sun was in the water before Peter noticed it. A wavy circle of gold on the surface of the sea. A fisherman is usually the first to spot. Now listen. A fisherman is usually the first to spot the sun rising over the crest of the hills. A fisherman. It means his night of labor is finally over. But not for this fisherman. Though the light reflected on the lake, the darkness lingered in Peter's heart. See, the wind chilled, but he didn't feel it. His friends slept soundly, but he didn't care. The nets at his feet were empty. The sea had been a miser, but Peter wasn't thinking about that. His thoughts were far from the Sea of Galilee. His mind was in Jerusalem, reliving an anguished night. As the boat rocked, his memories raced. The clanking of the Roman guard, the flash of the sword, and the duck of a head. A touch for Malchus, a rebuke for Peter. Soldiers leading Jesus away. "What was I thinking?" Peter mumbled to himself as he stared at the bottom of the boat. "What was I thinking? Why did I run?" Peter had run. He had turned his back on his dearest friend and run. We don't know where. Peter may not have known where. He found a hole, a hut, an abandoned shed. He found a place to hide, and he did. He had bragged, "Everyone else will stumble, but I will not," Matthew 26:33. Yet he did. Peter did what he swore he wouldn't do. He had tumbled face first into the pit of his own fears. And there he sat. All he could hear was his hollow promise. "Everyone else may stumble, but I will not. Everyone else, I will not, I will not, I will not." A war raged within the fisherman. At that moment, the instinct to survive collided with his allegiance to Christ. And for just a moment, allegiance won. Peter stood and stepped out of hiding and followed the noise till he saw the torch-lit jury in the courtyard of Cyprus. He stopped near a fire and warmed his hands. The fire sparked with irony. The night had been cold, the fire was hot, but Peter was neither. He was lukewarm. Peter followed at a distance. Luke describes us in Luke 22:54. He was loyal from a distance. That night he went close enough to see, but not close enough to be seen. The problem was Peter was seen. Other people near the fire recognized him. "You were with him," they had challenged. "You were with the Nazarene." Three times people said it, and each time Peter denied it, and each time Jesus heard it. Please understand that the main character in the drama of denial is not Peter, but Jesus. Jesus, who knows the hearts of all people, knew the denial of his friend. Three times the salt of Peter's betrayal stung the wounds of the Messiah. How do I know Jesus knew? Because of what he did. Then the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Luke 22:61. When the rooster crowed, Jesus turned. His eyes searched for Peter and they found him. At that moment, there were no soldiers, no accusers, no priests. At that pre-dawn moment in Jerusalem, there were only two people, Jesus and Peter. Peter would never forget that look. Though Jesus' face was already bloody and bruised, his eyes were firm and focused. They were like a scalpel laying bare Peter's heart. Though the look had lasted only a moment, it lasted forever. And now, days later on the Sea of Galilee, the look still seared. It wasn't the resurrection that occupied his thoughts. It wasn't the empty tomb that occupied his thoughts. It wasn't the defeat of death that occupied his thoughts. It was the eyes of Jesus seeing his failure. Peter knew them well. He'd seen them before. In fact, he'd seen them on this very lake. This wasn't the first night that Peter had spent on the Sea of Galilee. After all, he was a fisherman. He, like the others, worked at night. He knew the fish would feed near the surface during the cool of the night and return to the deep during the day. No, this wasn't the first time or first night Peter had spent on the Sea of Galilee, nor was it the first night he had caught nothing. There was that time years before. Most mornings, Peter and his partners would sell their fish, repair their nets, and head home to rest with a bag of money and a feeling of satisfaction. This particular morning, there was no money. There was no satisfaction. They had worked all night, all through the night, but nothing. They had nothing to show for it except weary backs and worn nets. And what's worse, everyone knew it. Every morning the shore would become a market as the villagers came to buy their fish. But that day, there were no fish. Jesus was there that morning teaching. As the people pressed, there was little room for him to stand as the people pressed in on him. So he asked Peter if his boat could be a platform. Peter agreed, maybe, thinking the boat might as well be put to some good use. Peter listens as Jesus teaches. It's good to hear something other than the slapping of waves. When Jesus finishes with the crowd, he turns to Peter. He has one other request. He wants to go fishing. "Take the boat into the deep water and put your nets in the water to catch some fish," Luke 5:4. Can you just imagine? Peter groans. The last thing he wants to do is fish. The boat is clean. The nets are ready, dry. The sun is up and he is tired. It's time to go home. Besides, everyone is watching. They've already seen him come back empty-handed once. And what's more, what does Jesus know about fishing? So Peter speaks, "Master, we've worked hard all night trying to catch fish." Mark those weariness in his words. We've worked hard, scraping the hull, carrying the nets, pulling the oars, throwing the nets high into the moonlit sky, listening as they slap on the surface of the water all night. The sky had gone from burnt orange to midnight black to morning gold. Hours had passed as slowly as the fleets of clouds before the moon. The fishermen's conversation had stilled and their shoulders ached. While the village slept, the men worked all night long trying to catch fish. The night's events had been rhythmic. Net swung and tossed high till it spread itself against the sky. Then wait, let it sink. Pull it in, do it again. Throw, pull, throw, pull, pull, throw, throw. Every toss had been a prayer, but every drag of the empty net had come back unanswered. Even the net sighed as the men pulled it out and prepared to throw it in again. For 12 hours they'd fished, and now Jesus is wanting to fish some more, and not just off the shore, but out in the deep. Peter sees his friends shrug their shoulders. He looks at the people on the beach watching him. He doesn't know what to do. Jesus may know a lot about a lot, but Peter knows about fishing. Peter knows when to work and when to quit. He knows there is a time to go on and a time to get out. Common sense said it was time to get out. Logic said cut your losses and go home. Experience said pack it up and get some rest. But Jesus said, "We can try again if you want. The most difficult journey is back to the place where you failed." Jesus knows that. That's why he volunteers to go alone. The first outing was solo. This time I'll be with you. Try it again, this time with me on board. And Peter reluctantly agrees to try again. "But you say to put the nets in the water, so I will," Luke 5:5. It didn't make any sense, but he'd been around this Nazarene long enough to know his presence made a difference. That wedding at Cana, that sick child of the royal ruler, it's as if Jesus carried his own deck of cards to the table. So the oars dip again and the boat goes out. The anchor is set and the nets fly once more. Peter watches as the nets sink. And he waits. He waits until the net spread as far as his rope allows. The fishermen are quiet. Peter is quiet. Jesus is quiet. Suddenly the rope yanks. The net, heavy with fish, almost pulls Peter overboard. "John, James," he yells, "come quick." Soon the boats are so full of fish that the port side rims deep dips close to the surface. Peter, ankle deep in flopping silver, turns to look at Jesus, only to find that Jesus is looking at him. That's when he realizes who Jesus is. What an odd place to meet God, on a fishing boat, on a small sea, in a remote country. But such is the practice of the God who comes into our world. Such is the encounter experienced by those who are willing to try again with him. See, Peter's life was never again the same after that catch. Never again the same after that catch. He had turned his back on the sea to follow the Messiah. He had left the boats thinking he'd never return. But now he's back, full circle, same sea, same boat, maybe even the same spot. But this isn't the same Peter. 3 years of living with the Messiah have changed him. He's seen too much, too many walking cripples, too many vacated graves, too many hours hearing his words. He's not the same Peter. It's the same Galilee, but a different fisherman. Why did he return? What brought him back to Galilee after the crucifixion? Despair? Some think so. I don't. Hope dies hard for a man who has known Jesus. I think that's what Peter has. That's what brought him back. Hope, see? A bizarre hope that on the sea where he knew him first, he would know him again. So Peter is in the boat on the lake. Once again, he's fished all night. Once again, the sea has surrendered nothing. His thoughts are interrupted by a shout from the shore. Catch any fish? Peter and John look up. Probably a villager. No, they yell.